The truth is the truth, no matter how you- Summer is hungry.
Oh, yes, please forgive me. Would you like some?
No. Thank you.
Oh, then how about some entertainment? A day, dear. Play the piano for Mr. Summers.
I don't play the piano.
Yes, you do. I've heard you play many times. You play very well.
I've never played the piano.
Jane, Mr. Summers would enjoy some playing. Please play.
I don't know how.
How do you know? Have you ever tried?
No.
There, you see, then, cello is her real instrument. But we never talk about it.
Please play. Now, explain to me some of the events that led up to your attempted suicide.
Well, a few days ago, I woke up and I heard a voice saying it wasn't enough.
Did you recognize the voice?
Not at first, but then it started to come back to me. When I was 8 years old, somebody brought me to a theater with a bunch of other children. We come to see a production of Peter Pan. But I remember something seemed wrong about the whole thing. Odd things kept happening. Like, when the children would fly, the ropes would break and they'd come thumping to the ground, and they'd have to be carried off by the stagehands. There seemed to be an unlimited supply of understudies to take the children's places, and then they'd fall to the ground. And the crocodile that chases Captain Hook was a real crocodile. It wasn't an actor. And at one point it fell off the stage, crushing several children in the front row.
What happened to the children?
Several understudies came and took their places in the audience. And from scene to scene, Wendy seemed to get fatter and fatter until finally she was immobile and had to be moved by a cart.
And where does the voice fit in?
The voice belonged to the actress playing Peter Pan. Do you remember how in the second act, Tinkerbell drinks some poison that Peter's about to drink in order to save him? And then Peter turns to the audience and he says that Tinkerbell's going to die because not enough people believe in fairies. But that if everybody in the audience claps really hard to show that they do believe in fairies, then maybe Tinkerbell won't die. And so then all the children started to clap. We clapped very hard and very long. My palms hurt and even started to bleed, I clapped so hard. Then suddenly the actress playing Peter Pan turned to the audience and she said, "That wasn't enough. You didn't clap hard enough. Tinkerbell's dead." And all the children started to cry. The actors playing Peter Pan stopped off stage and refused to continue with the play, and they finally had to bring down the curtain. No one could see anything through all the tears, and the ushers had to help the children up into the aisles and out into the streets. I don't think any of us were the same after that experience.
How do you think this affected you?
Well, it certainly turned me against theater, but more damagingly, I think it warped my sense of life. You know, nothing really seems worth it if Tinkerbell's just going to die.
And so you wanted to die, like Tinkerbell.
Yes.
Jane, I have to take my wife to the hospital this afternoon, so I have to go now, but I will be back later today. I think you're going to be all right, but I think you need a complete rest. So when I come back, we can talk about putting you somewhere for a while.
You mean committing me?
No, this would be a rest home, a completely temporary thing. Tinkerbell just needs her batteries recharged, but that's all. Now you just make your mind a blank, and I'll be back as soon as I can.
Thank you. I'll try to stay quiet until your turn.
Oh, you're leaving? Won't you have some of my cheese first?
Thank you, Mrs. Pramod, but I have to go. Please see to it that your daughter stays quiet.
Oh, you can rely on me.
Chin up.
Jane, dear, I brought you some sheet music. I thought maybe if you got some where Middle C was, it'll come back to you.
Please leave me alone.
I don't know why you turned against me.
cool that voice was the cello.
A good daughter does not talk to her mother in that tone. I'm sure you didn't mean it. When you're ready to play the piano, let me know.
Mr. Summers, your psychologist. I don't understand.
my wife. Oh, even within France, their true home, and these people love you for the great gift you have given them.
No, but what about my husband and the rest of my family?
Bring them all along. I have a big heart.
That's most generous, but I must consult my daughter Jane. Jane, dear.
Sweetheart, did you hear the count's offer?
No.
Yes, you did. Do you approve?
No.
Yes, you do. You work with us to France.
No.
Yes, you do. Oh, count, you agreed to everything.
Oh, darling.
My count.
Mother, what is the meaning of this? Edith?
Now, Dwayne, Arthur.
Edith, I'm shocked. Don't jump to any hasty presumptions, Montserrat from that.
The Count and I were discussing my going back to the stage.
You've used that story before.
Yes.
Yes, you have.
Albert, don't be belligerent.
Arthur.
Oh, Arthur, don't be belligerent.
Father, don't use that tone with my mother.
Oh, Dwayne, don't be cross to your father.
I think it is terrible that you speak rudely to Madame Fromage.
Granddad's having a talk with it. Dwayne, she's quite a little better than grandfather's water.
You're just trying to distract me, maybe, isn't you?
No, how could you be so cruel? Cool? Show me!
Dwayne, listen to your mother.
Mother, we've got to get this settled first. Who do you love more, me, father, or the count?
Now, do you mean more frequently or in greater degree?
Degrees?
Oh, oh my God, he's fainted!
Good God, Edith, is he dead?
No, he's just sleeping.
Oh.
Well, who do you love more?
Now, Dwayne, when you ask any woman that, you ask her to explain her existence, and so I will. Dwayne, I love you as a mother loves a son, as a wife loves a husband, and as a woman loves a lover. Arthur, I love you as a son loves a husband, as a husband loves a lover, and as a woman loves a mother. Oh, a count, I love you as a pastor loves a friend, and as a woman loves a lover, and as a brother loves a sister. It's all for one and one for all. There, are you satisfied?
Mother, you're wonderful.
Yes.
Edith, I'm touched.
Arthur, dear.
Oh, madame, you are so mountain. Oh.
Ah! point, it seems in order to offer the psychological key to this evening's performance.
Jane's repressed fear of carrots, indicated by her refusal to acknowledge her proper surname, mirrored a disorder in her libidinous region,
which in turn made her unable to distinguish between her father, grandfather, and brother. As long as she could not recognize to whom she was speaking to,
she would not have to react to them sexually. When Jane finally released the forces of her libido by whacking off the banana bread,
she freed her personality
and enabled herself to face
her festering
competition
with her mother.
The moral of the play is through the work of modern psychology,
man is able
to solve his problems
and be happy.
Thank you, and good night.
Gentities.